Hello, Mayor Aquanetta Warren here in the city of Fontana. As you have seen through the weeks, we have been addressing so many different issues and concerns, and we've made sure that we related most of those issues to COVID-19. We also have been talking about racism in our great nation and how we can develop racial reconciliation. But we've also been talking about lifestyles and quality of lifestyles. And we've had a couple of things going on, particularly with COVID, that we are beginning to pay attention to that we see more of. We see more homelessness going on, and we see more people having desperate situations within their homes and with other people. So we decided it was time for us to address another issue, and that issue is mental health. We had her earlier in this season to talk to us about mental health and the capacity of our county in addressing those issues. But recently, I had a conversation with a great pastor here where they befriended a young woman who needed help. And they did not have all of the tools, but no one could have perceived that this young woman was at her very end and felt compelled to take her life. So we're going to begin to provide those tools and that information more frequently, because mental health is in all of our lives. It's in our families, it's in our churches, it's in our places of business where we work, and we have to work together to provide the information to make sure that we address that issue now. So today joining me is Dr. Veronica Kelley from San Bernardino County. And I just want you to talk about some of your ideas that you are working on right now, and introduce yourself, your department, and what can you bring to this conversation?
Well, thank you, Mayor Warren, for the opportunity to speak about this really important topic, mental health. Like you said, mental health is so important because we all have it.
Right.
So it's not just something that affects them or those, it's all of us. And I'm the director for the County Department of Behavioral Health. So that's mental health and addiction services. We are the public system, and we are the support system, the safety net, if you will. And so what we are seeing with COVID-19, with what we're calling the second pandemic, which is racism and social injustice, as well as our other disasters like fire, is that people are responding in a certain way. And they're responding the way you would normally respond to a pandemic, with anxiety, with fear, and with depression. And so those are normal responses to a very abnormal situation. The issue, as you pointed out, is when the response persists. And so literally, if you cannot get out of bed in the morning versus you don't want to get out of bed in the morning, then you've got a problem. And that's where seeking services for mental health comes in.
You know, I tell you, when this pastor shared with me, unfortunately, I was not shocked. And that scares me personally, because we are seeing it, particularly in our senior community also, not only the young people. You know, our great community services department actually keeps in touch with our seniors that were enrolled in our program, so they know people care about them. And as we look at the numbers of the cases in San Bernardino County and here in our great city, what are you seeing in terms of the mental health impacts? You talked about anxiety, if you can't get out of bed, but there's some other things going on. Yeah,
there's a lot of things going on. I think COVID has really shown a light on where we need to really focus, which is making sure that all of us have mental health. Most of us will go and get a physical once a year, but we don't go get a mental health checkup, and we should. That would prepare us for what we're experiencing right now. What we've seen is people are experiencing a lot of unrest. They're anxious and they're nervous. If you really think about it, COVID-19 has impacted us such that it's caused huge losses. So we can talk about the economic loss, but think about when you are a person who loses your job. So not only have you lost money, not only have you lost your ability to provide for your family, But you also might have lost your identity, because we as adults are really tied up into our identity of what we do for a living, right? So if you no longer can do that, or you can't do it the way you wanted to, that changes how you see yourself. And so those are major losses. Also, we see that there's a difference in the way we respond to losses because of COVID-19. So if someone dies in the last 9 months, our ability to mourn, our ability to bury them and grieve is totally changed. It is very different. It's a huge shift for everybody. And so having this huge change is really impactful to everyone's mental health. And that doesn't mean that everyone has a mental illness, but it does mean that we are unsettled and we're feeling unstable.
You know, you brought up a good point about how we worry about our health and we go to the doctor, and but we're not seeking out those affirmation of who you are and counseling and all of those things. What's been, in the past 6 to 8 months, what's been the biggest challenge that you've had to deal with as a mental health provider even?
Well, in the past 6 to 8 months, we have had a huge increase in people wanting help. And we are set up, we serve about 60,000 unduplicated clients a year. That means 60,000 folks, we count just once. But now we have a whole group of other folks who have insurance. They don't know how to access their insurance for mental health benefits, or they might have relapsed in their addiction and they don't know where to go. So they've been calling us. And so our services have remained open during COVID-19. We've never closed. We've just seen an uptick in people wanting to get services. So probably about a 23% increase in calls to our crisis line. That includes our suicide prevention line. We've gone on one of our lines in earlier in the COVID-19 lockdown, we had about 21 calls a month. That would be our normal January, February. And that went up to 1,800 calls in March, April, and it's currently about 4,000 calls a month we're receiving to that line. The interesting thing is people are calling there asking for advice. So they're not saying I'm depressed or I feel I want to kill myself. They're just saying, how do I cope with this? Or I'm worried about my mother. She lives in a retirement facility. How do I make sure she's okay? So the mental health impacts are very broad, and they're reaching out and touching almost everybody.
That is incredible. What should we all be looking for in our families or our friends? You know, I have a friend, I haven't heard from her, and I call her. I just feel like I probably need to go by there. What should we be looking for? What are the signs?
So, great point. We need to be aware of any huge changes in behavior, right? So we know with COVID-19, we've all changed our behavior, but anything that's super significant. So if your friend would always return your call or your text immediately, and now you don't hear from them, that's a concern. So to reach out, make a visit, staying 6 feet away, of course, but right, making sure that they're okay. And then there are other signs that are really significant. So if someone is talking about feeling helpless or hopeless, if they are saying that they feel like they are a burden, if they start to give away prized possessions, or if they actually say, I'd like to kill myself, everyone would be better off, those are serious signs, and that's when we need to intervene. So a really good thing to do would be to listen. So I think our impulse is to say, no, no, you have so much to live for. And so what we've just done is placed a judgment on how they're feeling. And that really shuts someone who's feeling suicidal down. Better to ask, why do you say that? And then just shut our lip and listen. Sometimes, most of the time, just being validated for their feelings will get someone through. But really important, if someone tells you they want to kill themselves, don't leave them alone. Right, hang out with them, even text or call a friend and have them come relieve you. Try and get that person to go to their doctor with you, maybe seek out a counselor, or if it's a dire situation, of course you can always call 911.
And that's key. You don't just give up and say, I tried to help them, walk away, seek help.
Right.
Is it harder on the kids? I'm hearing from the parents, particularly with school not in place. And it's really rough if your parents are working and they're leaving you at home by yourself. Are you seeing more cases with the children?
Well, we are seeing more difficulty with the parents in dealing with, you know, their children who are at home. Maybe they have to now stay at home with them and they have work to do. What we've actually seen is about a 16% increase in our ability to work with children and their parents, because they're both home now. Where in the past, when children would come in for services, their parents might not have been available. And what we know is children are a lot more resilient than we think. It really is comes all down to the parent or the caregiver and how we are feeling. Our kids are going to take their cues for how to behave from us. So if we're really nervous or anxious about all of this going on, they will be the same.
You know, you talked about the suicides. Are you seeing an uptick in attempted suicides and in suicides? I know you said your numbers are going up, so I'm assuming so are the suicides.
We've seen an uptick in people saying that they feel suicidal. We aren't necessarily seeing an increase in people who've completed a suicide. But let me be clear, that's because when we get those numbers, it's a retrospective look, right? We look back on how many completed suicides were there last year. We don't have that information yet, so all we can go by is anecdotal. So we're seeing an increase in people asking for help, and that's really, really important.
So depression, anxiety within ourselves, if we feel that way and we don't want to share it with anyone, what are the resources available?
You can always call. So you can go to our website, sbcounty.gov/DBH for Department of Behavioral Health. We have a couple of COVID crisis lines where you can call. Those are toll free. We have an actual clinician who can answer the phone in English or Spanish. We are operating it from 7 in the morning until 10 at night. And a number would be 909-421-9233. Or you can text, because some people just don't want to talk. So you can text to 909-535-1316.
That is amazing. We're going to be showing those numbers down below here. So I think the bigger problem, Dr. Kelley, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, there is such a stigma. You know, personally, I have family members suffering through mental health issues. And at first, I didn't even want to talk about it. But now I find it to be more productive, and it helps me better understand them. So what do you tell people out there that think, you know, if I tell people I'm having mental health issues, they'll think something's wrong with me?
Well, COVID-19, these times we're in right now, have really demonstrated that we have not paid attention to mental illness and addiction in the way we should, and we're paying the price for it now. So I think now's a great opportunity for us. Lots of folks are seeking help, which is great. That reduces stigma. And then we need to talk about it. There is no difference between you having diabetes and you having depression. No difference. They exist in the same body. They are treated with medication and with coping skills and symptom management. In fact, if we look at diseases such as diabetes, diabetes is the most relapsing disease we have. It is more relapsing than addiction. And nobody would balk at saying, I have type 1 diabetes or I have type 2 diabetes. So we have to change that conversation. And the fact that you are doing this today is part of the changing of this narrative, that we have to talk about mental health because, again, as you stated at the top of this show, we all have it.
This is really what we've been trying to do with these conversations and these spaces, is to provide everyone out there with tools. Everyone is going through something. It's how you go through it. And also, if you'll look at what is being offered from our county, it is outstanding. They provide that extra help. And then it starts in your homes. At the dinner table, when you're playing games with each other, you should ask each other, how are you doing? And talk it out. Dr. Kelley, when you mentioned about racism as that other crisis, how does that all relate? I'd love to hear your take on that.
Well, it does. Racism and discrimination make us sick. Yes. We know that people who experience racism and discrimination, it has the same impact as any other traumatic event. It causes anxiety and depression. It is an actual thing. And so what we are seeing is it's contributing to people's resistance to get assistance for their mental health issues. We know that there's disparate treatment, and that many of our communities of color don't talk about mental health. It's even more taboo than the general population. My mother's Filipino, and if she knew I was on this TV program talking to you about mental health, it'd be a problem because it is very stigmatizing to many communities. So again, we just have to keep at it. We have to speak our truth, no matter what that truth is, if it's about racism or if it's about having a mental illness. When we see something, we need to say something, and we're pretty familiar with talking about that when we see something that might be a legal activity. But when you see a racist or discriminatory action occurring, it's important to call it out. We can't change it if we can't identify it. And I know it is very difficult for many of us to do that. But when that uncle at Thanksgiving says his racist joke, you have to call it out, or we will never change. And then it's important that we get active, that we are activists. So we can donate money or sign a petition, but we need to come up with something to do so that we are part of the solution instead of being part of the problem.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kelley. I always enjoy talking to you. When we first started our COVID updates, I just can't thank you enough. That was one of our best received shows that you were on. We did it in Zoom. I'm glad we could finally be in person here, almost 9 feet apart from each other.
Me too.
But it's still, the words that you're saying are so strong. And we all need to look in that mirror and see how we can be better part of the solution. We know we are around people that are struggling right now. Don't ignore them, help them. And if you don't know how to, we're providing you with the data so that you can get them in touch with those that can. But I just want to thank all of you that continue to go get tested, that are washing their hands for over 20 seconds, that are making sure they're doing social distancing, and more importantly, that are looking out for each other. So let's continue to do that, Fontana. And thank you, Dr. Kelley, for joining us today. And we look forward to making clear that Fontana together moves Fontana forward. Thank you for joining us.